on the channel.
Yo. Yeah, what's up, everybody? It's time for Yo. MTV Raps with Fab Five Freddy, the host with the most.
That led us into the next, I guess, big era of rap, where the show was the first time that, you know, everybody in the country was able to hear the same record at the same time.
The phenomenal success of Yo MTV Raps in the late 80s ushered in a new wave of hip-hop superstars.
Can I kick it?
Yes, you can.
You can.
Boom. Now with Yo MTV Raps, you're on every week. Boom, with the penetration of video on MTV, you're on every day.
So to you other kids all across the land, there's no need to argue, parents just don't understand.
Stop, check it out, my man. This is the music of a hip-hop band.
Something that we
can't flow.
Stereotypes, they got to go.
Got to go.
After 12, I'm worse than a gremlin. Feed me hip-hop and I start trembling.
So unlike a lot of other forms of black music, which were known basically through the records and maybe you went to the concert or saw a TV appearance, it was everywhere. The videos pushed that out there in a way that no other black music style has ever been pushed out there.
It's true. True.
I know I love you.
By the end of the 80s, hip-hop music would become a regular visitor to the US pop charts. Courtesy of MTV, hip-hop moved beyond its original fan base in New York into Middle America and beyond. The mood of the period was best captured by Def Jam, the first label to specialize exclusively in rap.
The first Def Jam ad campaign was the Def Jam logo, and it said, Our artists don't sing. And then in parentheses it says, because they can't.
Beginning in 1985 with acts like LL Cool J, Def Jam was the label that fine-tuned rap's attitude of uncompromising rebelliousness. But the act that defined the label was Public Enemy. Public Enemy had something rap had never seen before. An ideology.
We liked the fact that they were, you know, about change. You know, youth culture is about change, and their change was focused. You know, it wasn't about, you know, I just want to change things for the hell of it, which is a rock and roll attitude. They had a hip-hop attitude. I want to change things because they're wrong.
As well as a DJ and two rappers, Public Enemy also had an onstage security force called the S1Ws, short for Security of the First World. Patrolling the stage in combat fatigues, their very image caused alarm, as did the group's lyrics about black pride and empowerment. But more alarming than either of these things to most listeners was the sheer abrasiveness of the noise chaos that was Public Enemy's music.
I wanted to make records that girls hated because my whole thing is like, you know, you had Luther Vandross and love songs. And, I loved R&B when it was in the 60s. And by the time it got to the 80s, it was like garbage, you know. It was just like, you know. So whatever my girl liked at the time, you know, if she was saying turn it off, I knew that I had some shit. So my whole thing was like, don't make anything that your woman likes, to make some rugged, real hip hop.
We deliberately did not use melodies. We deliberately made sure that things were out of tune. We deliberately made sure that certain things was out of time, because we wanted to create a feeling. We could have easily put melodies, timing, all that stuff in right, in sync. It wouldn't have had no potency. We wanted to make sure that the music was strong. We wanted our coffee black.
Don't believe the hype.
Yes.
In 1988, It Takes a Nation of Millions to Hold Us Back reached the top 30 of the US national album charts. But more important than its sales was the uncompromising political stance that made it the first concept album in rap.
The follower of Farrakhan, he'll tell me that you understand until you hear the man.
Throughout It Takes a Nation is topics. that we're going to tackle, and topics that a lot of people can relate to, and topics that are not going to be covered by a lot of people on the outside. And basically, It Takes a Nation was, I guess, the first piece of grown-up rap.
I'm talking about
just as important as the political contents of the album were the production techniques used to produce a wave of sound that producer Hank Shockley termed music's worst nightmare.
Chuck will be on one turntable, Eric will be on the drum machine hitting the little fills, I'll be on a sampler, and Flav may have a sampler. So now we're all in the studio, and everybody's just making. If you came in there, you would have saw we was making mess, cause nothing. It was just everybody was just doing whatever, and it was all everybody at the same time playing, and everything that came out the speakers, it was horrible. It was just noise, but we would tape it all, and then there would be one point in that whole tape that we found a groove that was crazy. And that's what we would use to be the foundation for the song.
I put this together too. The bells of those that boost the dose of lack and those that sell the black shame on the brother when he dealing.
But while Public Enemy's politically conscious rap won plenty of praise and even success for the group, it didn't provide a lasting trend for the music. Rap music was about to take a very different direction.
You can't touch this.
Until the late 1980s, rap music's home was in New York and the East Coast of America. That was about to change. On the other side of the country, in West Coast California, a fledgling hip-hop community was struggling to make its mark. The first West Coast rapper to break through was from the city of Los Angeles, and he went by the name of Ice-T.
This is Ice-T talking to you, boy. I'ma tell you what time it is. Yo, it's time for me to pump up the volume. No problem, the record's revolving. Evil's the mixer, I'm the rap trickster. Paparazzi's on the bum rush for pictures.
I think the big breakthrough in West Coast rap was us just getting our own identity. I think that's the key to any hip-hop. You have to be about where you're from. You cannot be in the South trying to rap about New York.
I know you're loving this drug as it's coming out your speakers. Bass through the bottoms, highs through the tweeters.
By rapping about crime and violence on the streets of L.A., Ice-T created a style that was much more hard-edged than anything offered on the East Coast rap scene.
Just ruin your natural high. Why, that ain't fly, and anyone who says it is lies.
You are now about to witness the strength of street knowledge.
While Ice-T was the first to create a distinctive West Coast sound, a bigger impact would be made by a group from a district of L.A. called Compton.
Straight out of Compton, crazy motherfucker named Ice Cube, from the gang called Niggas With Attitudes.
They went by the unforgettable name of Niggas With Attitude, or N.W.A.
You too, boy, if you fuck with me, the police are gonna have to come and get me off your ass. That's how I'm going out. For the punk motherfuckers that's showing out, niggas want to mumble, they want to rumble. Makes a man cook them in a pot like gumbo. Going off on the motherfucker like that, with a cat, that's pointed at your ass.
We was just being us. That's how we dressed, that's how we looked, this is where we was from. And this is what was going on in our neighborhood. It wasn't contrived in any kind of way. We was just hip-hopping, man, doing what we do. And we knew one, you know, once you know, you couldn't play this record for your grandmother. You know what I mean? We knew that. So we knew that it was shock in a way, but we still had things to say.
What N.W.A. had to say had never been heard on record before. Straight Outta Compton pulled no punches, describing ghetto life and gang activity in explicit detail.
What's up? Tell him where you're from.
Straight Outta Compton, a brother with his finger on the trigger. But once I take out, my rep gets bigger. I'm the roof is filling and you know this. But the suckers in the public won't show this.
We're just, you know what I'm saying, trying to put Compton on the map. If you grow up in any black neighborhood or whatever, you got it. They got gangs, you know what I'm saying? I ain't been the one that don't have no gangs. They got gangs. So you gotta deal with that, you know what I'm saying?
You might take it as a trip, but a brother like Brand is on a gangster tip straight out of Compton.
N.W.A.'s raw, unsparing delivery set down a whole new style of rap music, and the Straight Outta Compton album was hailed as a groundbreaking, if somewhat controversial, musical landmark.
And when NWA hit, NWA did.